But anyway, if you guys will stand to your feet, I'm going to challenge my youth a little bit. So if you're in our youth, I want you guys to come up here and worship. I want you guys to show everybody this morning what it looks like to just give your all this morning. So if you're in my youth, I want you guys to come up. No, you guys can face this way. Okay? Now let's just worship this morning. Heavenly Father, we just come to you, Lord. Father, with a grateful, cheerful heart, Father, we want to come to honor you in this house. We say, come and take over this morning, Lord. We open our ears to you, our hearts, Father, to you this morning. We say, come and have your way. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's sing it out.
Born. Life begins and ends in the dust you form. Faith commanded and the mountains move.
Hallelujah.
Fear is losing ground in our hope in you. Unstoppable God, let your glory go. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be impossible. Your kingdom reigns unstoppable. We'll shout your praise forevermore. Jesus, our God, unstoppable. Nothing shall be. Oh, you're the unstoppable God.
makes a way where there seems to be no way, amen. He makes a way. So Father, this morning we praise you. We honor you, Lord. That is our weapon of warfare. No matter what's going on or whatever we're going through, Lord, the one thing we cling to are the praises that we sing unto you and we battle through, Father. Hallelujah. Let praise be a weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are, proclaim your victory. Let it rise. Let faith arise. Yes. We'll see you break down every wall. Watch the giants fall, for fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side, forever lift him high. With all creation cries, God, we praise you. The song that calms the storm inside of me. Let it rise. Let faith arise. Yes. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cries, God, we praise you. We lift it up to you, Jesus. Oh, we say, come now, Lord. We praise your name. Father, we say, break down every wall in this house. Break down every wall. I speak freedom in this house. Speak freedom, because where there's freedom, there is joy, there is peace. Come on, this is what it looks like. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. For fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cries, God, we praise you. You're gonna do, even when we don't see it or feel it. God, you're still moving. You're still moving and making way. You're still making ways. You're still making a way where there seems to be no way. don't see it, I want you to know he's still there. He's making a way. Stir yourself up in your most holy faith now. Stir yourself up in your most holy faith now. Stir it up, and don't let it die. But cling to what you know.
Oh, come on, my soul. Oh, don't you get shy. calm on my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord.
Come on. Hallelujah.
Oh, come on my soul. Oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, cause all
it's more than enough. It's more than enough. It's more than enough to exalt our King of Kings. It's all He desires is Your all, and it makes it more than enough. It makes it more than enough. You're more than enough. Because He's alive and well in you. He's alive and well in you. He's breathing His life back into your lungs. Come on, just tell yourself this morning, come alive in me, Lord. Shake up my tradition. Shake up all those rules and those ideas and putting you in a box. Shake all that up. Take all that away. Stir it up within me, Lord, that I may be able to praise You and exalt You. Without shame, without fear, without doubt. But knowing that You are the great I Am. You are the El Shaddai. You are Jehovah Jireh. You are the Alpha and the Omega. You are my everything. Stir it up inside of us. Come alive inside of us. Oh, great I Am. Come alive in us. Come alive, come alive, come alive in us.
So You give life, You are love, You bring light to the darkness, You give hope. Restore.
Father, you are so great. You are so mighty. You are so wonderful. You are so patient. You are so kind. Reminding us of whose we are and what we have living inside of us. That we would not live in a box or in a legalistic thinking or even think, oh, this is the way that God would do it. But that we would be led by your Spirit, not our own understanding, but yours. We receive your wisdom this morning. We receive your knowledge for us this morning. But not only do we receive it, Father, we apply it this morning. We activate it. Come on. We activate it in this house this morning. Every word that you're speaking to us now, Lord, we activate it and we say yes. We say yes. Come on, everybody say, we say yes. We say yes to you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's just thank him this morning with some praise in this house. Lord, we thank you, Jesus. On your way back to your seat or before you sit down, I want you guys to turn around and hug somebody, welcome somebody this morning that you don't know, that you didn't come with. Get out your seats, cross the aisles, get to know your family, get to know those that you war with in the Spirit. Amen.
Good morning. It's great to see everyone. I want to read it for tithing, but I've always believed our own testimony is better than any scripture that we can read in applying that to something. And I don't know about y'all, but I cannot think of a time when I look back and say, man, I ran out of too much month at the end of my paycheck, but I made it several times. And I know you have too. And as I read this scripture, I want you to remember, all these things are going through my head right now, so forgive me. But as a parent, I taught my son and never to steal. If they wanted something, if we could afford it, we would afford it. And I want to ask, how much is your salvation worth? $100? $200? $300? $4? $5? It's much more than that. I know mine is, and I know yours is too. And as I remember teaching my son never to steal, my kids never to steal, the Lord dealt with me and said, why have you not been giving and tithing like you should have? Who am I stealing from? The Lord. So if that message goes out to my son and my kids and my grandkids now, It's a lesson that we ourselves need to know. It's all His. Every bit of it is His. So if we keep something a little extra for us, what are we doing? We're stealing from God. And He will do everything for us. Malachi 3:10 says, "Test me, try me." He'll hold His part of the bargain, His part of the scripture. His word is truth. And I want to pray as we, there's several ways that we can give. There's online, easy tithe, the pillars. Come. And let's give God what is His anyway, in obedience to His word. Father God, I just come before You, Jesus, and I thank You for all the things that You've done in my life. I thank You, Father God, that I am without, Father God, never. You've always supplied. You've always held the devourer at bay, Father God. You've always said to test You. And Father God, I thank You, Father God, Lord Jesus, that out of my heart, will give, Father God, and give abundantly, Father God, for what is Yours anyway. Father God, I ask a special blessing and a special prayer for those, Father God, that are traveling. Father God, I ask for those that, Father God, that need something today, Father God, from You. Father God, whether it's salvation, whether it's a blessing, whether it's just love, Father. Father God, I thank You for this family. I thank You, Lord Jesus, for HFA, Father God. And I ask You, Lord Jesus, to bless this and multiply it, Father God, so it'll go back to them. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Hops First Assembly. Here are your weekly announcements.
If you're a first-time guest, we'd love the opportunity to get to know you better. There is a Connect card located in the seat back in front of you. If you'd fill it out and take it to the Welcome Center after service, we'd love to meet you. If you're watching service online, you can click the guest button on our website at hopsfirstassembly.org and fill out the Connect card there.
Good morning, Hops First Assembly. Here are this week's announcements. First of all, we would like to invite all the men this Saturday at 8 o'clock on the 28th in the Life Center for a men's breakfast, a time of fellowship, and devotion. Also, on Sunday the 29th, we will be welcoming our new pastors, Pastor Cameron and Sarah VC. We would love for you guys to hang out after service as we celebrate them by having a potluck Mexican luncheon. You can sign up at the Information Center. Make sure to put your name and out the site, put what dish you will be bringing. Because of this great celebration, we are going to be moving baptisms to February the 5th, the following weekend. So if you are interested in being baptized, please make sure to also sign up at the Information Center. God bless you guys, and that's all our announcements this week. Now let's prepare our hearts for the message.
So this morning, my message is about transformation. So when I think about transformation, I think about superheroes, right? I think about the Incredible Hulk. How many of you men would put your bicep up and show your big muscles, right? Or pretend that you're Superman or Spider-Man, right? So when Peter Parker turns into Spider-Man, and have the super senses and all that, we get excited when we see Superman in all his, flying ability and his super strength. Man, it's just, we love those type of transformation. But my favorite's got to be Ignacio, okay? Nacho Libre. Because he's the real thing. How many of you guys have watched that show? Many, many times, right? But he's actually a real person. Superman and Wonder Woman and all of that, they're great. We love, watching them. But they're just make-believes, right? When Peter Parker transformed into who? Spider-Man, right? So I've been married 18 years. And my wife and I love my wife. She's just amazing. She's my hero. So 3 days after we got married, We went on our honeymoon to the Philippines. And then after that, we decided to stay and do mission work. So my wife, we stayed at the mountains where there's no electricity, there's no running water. And so my wife, an American white girl blonde, going to the mountains with all these children, right? And they would bring a little matchbox, and inside there, guess what it was? It was like spiders. Spiders. So they would take the spiders and they would play with them. And I thought, okay, and I'm sure I played with them when I was a little kid too, because we don't have much. So I thought to myself, Spider-Man, Peter Parker, how many times have I gotten bitten by the spiders and I don't have any superpowers, right? I can't climb the buildings or have super senses. And so there was just no way, because it's a make-believe. It's not real. But I'm going to tell you who's real, and that is the Lord. I can tell you that He is the all-powerful God, and together we're going to talk about transformation. So from the beginning, since the creation, transformation has always been taking place. Can we have that? Yes. The earth was nothing, it was full of darkness, and God, who is all-powerful, transformed a voidless earth into something that was good. Genesis 1:1-4. In the beginning, God created. So the word created here is the word bara. When we say bara, that means that He created something out of nothing. So He created something new. By the power of the Holy Spirit, the heavens and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God, ruach, or wind, was hovering over the face of the water. Then God said, let there be light. With His word, this is the God we serve. He said, let there be light. And He transformed something, darkness, into light. With His word, He's a real deal. Then God said, and God saw the light and that it was good, and God divided the light from darkness. Then God said, they were contemplating, they were thinking, this is the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, over all the earth, and everything on the earth. So God created bara. Not bara, but He created something out of nothing in His own image. The image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. So we see here that the transformation of the world, God, who is our God, who we love, who we care, who we worship, created something out of nothing. He was transforming something amazing. When Peter Parker transformed into Spider-Man, that's make-believe, right, Peter Pan? Is there anybody here that likes Peter Pan? Or how about women? Okay, let's say Linda Carter. Do you know who Linda Carter is? You probably don't know who Linda Carter is, but it's actually Diana Prince, right? Turning into who? Wonder Woman. But these are not real. They're not real. They're just made-up people, but God is all powerful. Let me just explain this. God's transformation of the world and humanity was perfection. There was harmony and order in all that God created. The Creator was one with His creation until Adam sinned and caused spiritual death. So we know what happened here. God created the world in 6 days. He made all these amazing things. Some He created, okay, created, and some He already formed that was already created. So then, man was created in the likeness of God. And we all know what happened here. God told Adam, do not eat from this tree. And what did he do? We'll probably say, well, Eve did it, right? She did it first. But why is it that God always talks about Adam rather than Eve? Okay, it's unfair, right? Women empowerment was like, hey, wait a minute. But for me, God specifically told Adam not to do it. God spoke to Adam face to face. Adam, don't do this. Because at that time, Eve was not created yet. It was an intentional sin. Can you imagine walking with God in the cool of the day? He transformed something so beautiful, and here's man and God walking, and there was unity. There was order. But because of disobedience, that transformation, a different kind of transformation, was going to take place. A place of order and chaos has become a place of chaos. And that's what disobedience does. Humanity's problem with sin, whether it was inherited by choice, by our environment, or people's influence embedded deep within us. Because of this, we need a deep work of transformation as believers, the body of Christ, and the world. And that's exactly what I want to share with you guys this morning, is that we need this type of transformation as the believers, as the body of Christ, and eventually the world. And transformation comes through Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit and His Word, and through our obedience. Romans 5, 15 to 16. But there's a great difference between Adam's sin and God's gift, gracious gift. For the sin of this one man, Adam, brought death to many. But even greater is God's wonderful grace and His gift of forgiveness to many. Through this other man, Jesus Christ, and the result of God's gracious gift is very different from the result of one man's sin. For Adam's sin led to condemnation, but God's free gift led to our being made right with God, and even though we are guilty of many sins. I look at you guys today, you and me, we have a common ground on why we're here. And I do believe that the reason why you guys are here and I'm here is because somehow God has made Himself a revelation to us. That somehow God spoke to you, the Father drew you, and you gave your life to Jesus Christ. That's our common ground, right? But have you ever wondered why, even though you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you still sin? Like you try to do right. You try not to yell at your kids, right? You try not to cheat at school. You try not to gossip. You try not to do awful things. But why is it that even though we are Christians, we still sin? I do believe that the reason for that is, number one, that it's inherited. It's a natural instinct for man to sin. Why? Because we inherited that from Adam. And then I do believe also that it's also by choice. We sin because, hey, we like it. Ain't nobody going to tell us what to do because we like it. Right? So it's by choice. And sometimes we sin because of our environment. So why am I talking about this transformation? As the body of believers, as individual body of believers here, I need transformation in my life, and you need transformation in your life. Galatians 5:17 to 24. For the desires of the flesh are against the spirit, and the desire of the spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you're led by the spirit, you're not under the law. Now the work of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the things like this. Did I just say that out loud here? It's in the word. It's in the word. Basically, it's sexual sin, right? I think sometimes we kind of try to hide it because, man, it's just as sensitive, but it's in the word. Orgies, sexual sin, it's in the word. And why did Paul say that? He's talking to the church in Galatia. He said, I'm going to emphasize in Galatians 5:24, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passion and desires. That's the key word here. We, as the body of Christ, as Christians, have to get transformed. We have to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, so that the things that we used to do, we should no longer do. And that transformation comes when we are willing and open to the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. But if we are so prideful and defensive when God speaks to us, and even through your brother or your sister, and you get defensive, it's a matter of how you speak, I guess. If you're like up in their face and be like cussing them, I guess that's not good. But if you talk to them in love, perhaps that might work, right? So this transformation as a believer is crucial for us, because the flesh, what we're used to, because before you receive Jesus Christ, you have certain sets of things that you did as a sinner. You have set patterns and mindset. So all of that, when we gave our life to Jesus Christ, does it automatically come off? For some people, it clicks like that. For some of us, it takes our surrender. It takes our willingness to say, Lord, okay. Or sometimes you have to face up to it, because sometimes you're blinded. You know it, but you hide it and you play the game. We all do. So Paul says in Galatians 5:24, and those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desire. As I was preparing this and praying and fasting, my wife and I wanted to share this illustration with you guys about the old chief teaching his grandson about life. And I want to quote this to you. He said, a fight is going on inside of me. He said to the boy, it's a terrible fight, and it's between two wolves. One is evil. He is anger, envy, regret, greed, arrogance, self-pity. And the other is good. His joy, peace, love, hope, serenity, humility, kindness, benevolence, empathy, generosity, truth, compassion, and faith. The same fight is going inside you and inside every one of us. The grandson then asked the grandfather, which wolf will win? And the grandfather said, the one you feed. The one you feed. I would say that there's a white dog or a black dog, maybe not literally, right? Not literally, inside of us, fighting. The white dog is like, hey, do what God tells you to do. And the black is like, no, there's no way, right? They're fighting constantly. So the moral of the story is, which one are you feeding? Which one are you feeding? Are you feeding jealousy? Are you feeding envy? Labeling, competition? Are you feeding the flesh? What are we feeding? If we are feeding that, guess what's going to happen? Who's going to grow stronger? Evil. The black. Sin. But if you feed it with God's word, you feed it with the presence of the Lord in your life, then what's going to happen? Our spiritual man or our spiritual life will grow stronger, and that's what's going to take over. And that's why we as believers have got to be transformed, because you can't do it by yourself. Good intention can't do it. Chance can't do it. You know, and New Year's resolution can't do it. If we really want to be transformed as the believers, as the body of Christ, then we're going to have to be intentional and say, my flesh says this, but my spirit says this, and the word of God says this, and I'm not going to listen to my flesh. Who are we feeding? Are we feeding arrogance, territorial? What are we feeding? Or do you have the love of Jesus that people can come to you, they feel safe? So when we're transformed as believers, guess what? The world around us is going to be transformed as well, but we can't do that with good intention. Second Corinthians 3:17-18. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed. The key word here for transform is metamorpho, from the word metamorphosis, into the image from glory to glory, just as the Spirit of the Lord. The answer to our transformation is God's word. That's It's God's word. That's the only thing that's going to transform our old mindset. And if we don't get into the word, then other things are going to get in. And that's going to dominate our life. Romans 12:2. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what's God's will and his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Hey, I'm not perfect, and no one here is. There's none of us are perfect, but you know what? We do serve a perfect God. We do have the perfect one inside of us, and he will teach us if we're willing, right? There's no condemnation here saying, oh, you're better than me or I'm better than you. Transformation takes place according to how you are willing to be transformed. Just because one person is willing to be transformed and you see them grow and the other is waiting and playing whatever, hey, we have our own seasons of transformation. And it is very crucial, which will lead me to my next point, that when a brother or a sister is transformed and we see them, the fruit of the Spirit is in their life, there's no need to be prideful about that or thinking that you are so much more religious than the others. Because I think the body of Christ have many religious people, but not a lot of transformed believers who has the power to be used by the Holy Spirit to help transform others. Mark 9:2-3. This same transformation, metamorpho, that I'm talking about. And after 6 days, Jesus took him, Peter, and James, and John, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. We see here that Jesus transfigured, transformed. And that's the same word, metamorpho, that's describing this type of transformation. So how can a transformation happen in a believer's life? Number one, do not conform to this world system. The world's going to try to conform us. And it's easy to be conformed by the world, especially when we don't know God's word. Because we get confused. Because it sounded good. Remember Eve? Sounded good. Two, focus on God's word. We can be transformed as we behold the face of God, spending time in his glory. And we have to remember to yield. We have to yield in order for us to be transformed. We have to yield. And my next point, the second point I'm trying to share this morning is the transforming of the body of Christ. And I'm going to spend a little bit of time here. I have been a born-again believer for probably 33 years. And I'm 52, I'm going to be 52 in just in April. And I remember my first time going to a Pentecostal church, maybe, born-again believer church. I grew up Catholic, okay, so it was a shock. I got invited to a local church here in Hobbs that I just dearly loved. That's where my world was transformed. And I remember at first being hesitant, and I walked in and everybody was happy and joyful and not solemn like I was used to, and people were like, how are you doing, welcome, and then worship, praise and worship came. I've never experienced anything like this in my whole life. So there was jumping and singing loud and just crying, and I thought, is this some kind of a cult or something? I mean, is this for real? Because I grew up Catholic, so I've never seen anything like this before. But then I started to cry. I just cry. Like, I couldn't stop it. The presence of the Lord through that worship service was just, I couldn't stop it. And I fell in love. I fell in love with Jesus. And it changed my life completely. He changed my life completely. And I was faithful to this local church for many years, and I've seen the unity of the body and power. But I also seen the disunity of a body that destroys life. And that's why I believe that the body of Christ needs to be transformed. And you can't have transformation without believers who are transformed. And we have to come to a place, because the Lord will come for us one day. And everything that we do here on this earth as a believer is going to be tested with fire, and what remains will be rewarded. God's heart for the believers is to love one another. I'm not saying we're always going to be, what is it called? We're always going to agree. Right? You say Dallas Cowboy and everybody goes, woo! You say Dallas Cowboy and everybody goes, woo! But then you call out another football and they're like, team was like, we can't even agree. We can't agree on things. So I'm not saying that we just have to be in agreement on everything. I mean, it's impossible. We're flesh, we're human, right? But what I'm trying to say here is, body, in order for us to fulfill what God has called us to do, and that is the harvest, there needs to be a transformation within the body of Christ. We've got to stop competing with one another, comparing with one another. We got to stop the labeling, the judgment, okay? You look good, brother, but later on you go over and talk to another person about, did you see what he wore? Oh, hallelujah, praise the Lord, sister, you look good. Ooh, did you wear that short? Ooh, she wore that short the other day. Okay? There's too much division in the body of Christ. And people are laughing at us on the outside. And we're supposed to be the representative of Jesus Christ. But they're laughing at us. They're calling us hypocrites. Why? Because your words, my words, doesn't match with what God's word is. Paul said it this way. There was an issue with the Philippian church between Judea and Syntyche. And Paul loved the Philippian church. It's very special to him. They helped Paul financially. And so they have a really good relationship. So Philippians 2, Paul was in jail. He was chained to a Roman soldier. And so this guy named Epaphroditus, I think I can't even say his name right, gave him a report that there was an issue in the body of Christ. Now, we don't know what the issue are. We don't know why they were fighting, but it's in the Bible. Read it, Philippians chapter 2 or Philippians chapter 4. So then Paul wrote a letter and he said, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility. What if there's issues in the church and we deal with it with humility and maturity? Because there's going to be issues in the church. Why? Because we're flesh, we're human. What if we become so transformed as believers, as the body of Christ, that when there is issue in the church, we gather together. Our body, God made our body. When the body is sick, what happens? The white blood cells form together, right? To protect and heal that body. I've seen so many times in the body of Christ, when you don't like a member of the body, you just cut him off. Do you do that to your own physical body when something is not wrong or something is not right? Oh, I don't. My hand is hurt. I'm just going to cut it off. Or my head. Right? We're so quick to cut our brothers and sisters and put them in a place where they're judged rather than you pull them together. And here's another thing. You know why people can't share their deepest, darkest secret with you? Because they're afraid that when they tell you, you go off and blab to everybody else in the church. That's why there's such a distrust in the body of Christ today. And it shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. I was praying for the body of Christ. I was crying out to the Lord. We don't have a lot of time. And I was inspired to write this poem. I was actually inspired by my daughter, Asia. And I want to share it with you. And it's called Run the Race. Please open your heart to this. Open your eyes and see the brilliance of his face. His arms wide open as you run this race. Ups and downs and all around, trips and fall, face to the ground. His voice calling your name, get up and say no to shame. I see the bruises and I see blood. I see sweat pouring like a flood. Your lungs long for air. Your mind scream, it's not fair. You ran as hard as you can, not caring about opinion of men. Eyes on the prize you recite in your head. The finish line lays just up ahead. But malicious intent arose with a push. Jealousy and envy began their ambush. In slow motion, your body to the ground, laughter rang out an evil sound. Your knees oozing with blood, the street reverberates with a loud thud. Some just looked at you and kept walking, others with whispering and mocking. A trickle, then rain, finally the slew. Floodgates of anger began to brew. Team unity was the cry of our hearts, the same body with many parts. We serve together for a common cause, understanding that God is our ultimate boss. We worship together in one accord, ministry to bring honor to the Lord. Who hurt you for you to hurt me? You are my friend. How could this be? My body is torn apart, but that is not all. My spirit is heavy due to this fall. My soul wounded, undeniable, unfair, unjust, unforgivable. Then you look up to heaven and sob. Heart pounding, you felt robbed. I served you with my whole heart. I obeyed you from the start. Why, Lord, why? Listen to my cry. Gossip and labels, jealousy from your bride? This word will cause a great divide. Are we reflecting your grace and your beauty? Or suspicious, malicious, and disunity? Hurting people hurt people, but in the body of Christ? Shouldn't the pain he endured suffice? How are we supposed to show love to the lost when we ourselves haven't counted the cost? Why would your chosen allow all of this? I'm not sure if I want a part of this mess. Thunder roared, lightning flashed, heavy rain from heaven crashed. The voice of the shepherd came to my ear. He gently spoke to my anger and fear. With love, compassion, and gentleness, he reminded me of his unfettered goodness. The cross, the blood, and the sacrifice, the beating, the shame, he paid the price. The kiss, betrayal, and being sold, their hearts were hard and their love grew cold. The sins of the world on his shoulder, heavier than the biggest shook boulders. He said, I understand the pain inflicted on you. They cried, Hosanna, then crucify him too. My heart cries with you and I know the pain. By my death and suffering is not in vain. I love my body, my bride. It was for her that I bled and died. Get up, child, and run your race. I will correct, discipline, and show my grace. Guard your heart from hurt and bitterness. Doesn't everyone deserve my forgiveness? Together we'll face this pain with my grace. Forgive. Learn, grow, and run your race. The good work I started, I will complete. I gave my life for victory, not defeat. Run your race with perseverance. My prize awaits my reappearance. Our prize awaits his reappearance. Body, there's hope for us yet, right? There's hope for us. All right? The good work he started in us, he will complete. I'm running out of time. Running out of time. I have so much more to say, but that's okay. We'll do this. That poem was inspired when I had such a hard time with the body of Christ. When I was hurting and wounded, and I just began to pray. And that's what came out of my spirit, and I pray that encourages you guys to run your race regardless. There's a transformation that God is trying to build in us, and I could totally just preach on just that section, transformation of believers, transformation of the body of Christ. I can't even get into the transformation of the world, but I'm going to do this. I'm going to, before the Simpson tribe will come and minister, is this. There's a sense of the importance of transformation of believers in the body, because the world needs transformation. It's not just for us to keep. There are people who are hurting. Okay, I would encourage you to read John chapter 4, where Jesus met the Samaritan woman. That's what I was going to preach on, but we don't have much time. He broke cultural gender barrier, religious barrier. He broke all of that. Why? Because the harvest is plenty, but the workers are few. Wasn't that the command of Jesus for us to go into the world? But how can we do that when we're fighting against each other? Can't do that. They're going to laugh at us. I would like to call the Simpson tribe to come and minister to you through this dance.
And Father God, I pray that our families will come together right now and seek your face. You will forgive our sins and you'll heal our incredible land. In the name of the only Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Stay here. Good job. Can we have everybody, can you stand up for me? I'm going to honor our time. I could have totally preached another 45 minutes, but we don't have time. I'm going to honor our time because I understand there's a game today. I know that Jesus is more important, but if you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, you just never asked him. You don't have a relationship with him. And today, thank you, Miss Kiki. And today you want to do that. Is there anybody in here that has never given their hearts to Jesus and you want to do that today? Okay. How can you make a fist like this? And now can you stretch that and touch your neighbor with that fist? Connect with somebody. Don't punch him. We're not going to be violent or anything. If you could just connect. You see how sometimes we have to be crucified, not literally. We have to be transformed as a believer. We have to be transformed as the body of Christ so that we can go and transform the world. No more division. Do what you have to do to unite the body. Help the body unite. You can put your hands down. Be the change. We need each other. There's a war going on. You know that Satan wants to kill and destroy us. The gates of hell will not prevail against Jesus Christ, the rock. Jesus Christ, the rock. Can we close our eyes for a second? And I'm going to just pray over you. Father, we repent. We repent for our part to bring pain and division in your body, your bride. I pray that you would forgive us and cleanse us. I pray that you would help us be transformed in the renewing of our mind so that we as individual believers will be strong in the Lord in the power of his might. And that together as a local body of Christ here at HFA and all over the world, they will see the love of Jesus in our lives. As we transition, as pastors coming in, we pray blessing on him. And I pray that this church will be ready for the work of the Holy Spirit. Because this is a church of destiny. And we can't reach our destiny if there's division in the body of Christ. So I pray that you would pour out in us the grace having the same heart, same purpose. Help us unite in humility. Help us mature. And help us transform our particular world where we have been hurt ourselves. I pray for healing, deep healing, that you would do such a transformation in our hearts that we'll say, God has brought me out of, and I can help you now. We don't cut off a brother or a sister. We gather around them. What can I do to help you? We don't gossip our brothers and sisters. What can I do to pray for you? You're in need. Establish a trust even more so. Father, we need you. Jesus, you are the head of this church. And Holy Spirit, as we are willing to be transformed by you, do that work, the good work that you started in us. Let your words go forth in power, and let us remember that to be transformed by you is an ongoing thing. I give you all the glory and all the praise today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you guys for joining us for this week's service. If you asked Jesus to come into your heart or you rededicated your life, we want to know about it. So stay connected with us on our website. You'll see it below the screen. You'll go to connect. You'll go to prayer request, whatever it is that you need. We want to stay connected with you. Fill out the connect card with all your information. We promise not to blow up your email with a junk mail or anything like that, or call you or send you out mass text. We just want to know your information in case you need us. We are here for you. So we can't wait to see you guys next week. Please join us.